Lord, we thank you and praise you, magnify you. Thank you, God, for all that you have done for us. Thank you, Lord, for what you will do. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you will look upon us during this hour of your word, that your word will come forth. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that your word will be received, applied, and shared. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, for you have called us out of the world that we may share your word. And Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that you will confirm thy word by the signs, wonders, and workings of miracles as you have done in time past. And we know that you are still doing now. And we will now give you praise and the glory in Jesus' mighty name. And all people said, amen. Amen. Turn with me as we go to the gospel according to St. Mark. Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Mark, and starting at verse 2, and we are going to read through verse 10. The Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 9. And starting with verse 2. And it reads, After 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leading them up into a mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his raiment became shiny, exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias and with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said unto Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. For he wist not what to say, for they were sore afraid. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell, no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. And they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one another, what does rising from the dead mean? Those that have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. Amen. Our subject matter is a new revelation of Christ. A new revelation of Christ. We have so many people nowadays when it comes to the Lord, or when it comes to Jesus Christ, that so many people, particularly those who figure they are more anointed than so many other people. Yeah. Have you ever read across some of those people that think they are more anointed than everybody else, and that they have this special connection with Jesus that you don't have a connection with? But I think that I'm going to share a notice with you this morning. None of us has a monopoly on Jesus Christ.
Amen.
None of us know him for everything, for who he is. Amen. Because at one point in our lives, the Lord, he reveals to us on one hand on who he is. But as we grow in faith and as we grow in grace, that the Lord tends to reveal himself in a different way and a newer way to us. You see, here the disciples, they knew of Jesus, they heard of Jesus, they saw that he was able to feed a multitude with 5,000 fishes and 5,400. They knew that he was able to feed 5,000 with two fishes and 5 barley loaves of bread. They knew that he was able to raise the dead. They knew that he was able to walk on water. They saw how he opened the eyes of the blind. They saw how that he made the lame man walk. But what they did not know was, or what they had not seen, was Jesus in his glorious state. So what is that saying to us is that we may recognize, or we may recognize Jesus when he make ways for us out of no way, when he pay our, when he make ways for us to pay our bills, and we really know how we will go pay our bills. But then may recognize Jesus when we need something to eat, and we find out that he is a bread, and when you are hungry. And then we may find out that Jesus, when we are confused and we need to some sense of direction, and we find out that Jesus is a mind regulator. But there are some points in our lives to where we recognize, or the Lord will reveal himself to us in a newer and fantastic way. You see, at some point in our lives that we may start out believing what God will do, but then as we grow in grace, as we grow in grace and grow to know the Lord, that we come to know that we know what God will do. How many of us ever in our Christian journey that we started out believing what God will do, but then when we, as we grow in Christ, there are some things that we know that God will do. So then, as we grow, the Lord will reveal himself in a different way. He here that he grabbed with them 6 days later. He brought with them Peter, James, and John and went into the mountain apart to pray. But in your time, if you will read Matthew chapter 17, 1 through 9, as well as Luke chapter 9, verses 28 through 36. And that is Matthew chapter 17, 1 through 9. And then you have Luke 9, 28 through 36. And you'll find that as this narrative begins, that Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John. And you know that when Jesus was ministering on earth, that Jesus had at least 120 apostles or disciples. But out of that 20, that out of that 120, that he had 70. And out of that 70, he worked with the 12. And out of that 12, he worked closely with 3. So what is that saying to us is that as Jesus took Peter, James, and John on a mountain apart to pray, that he was going to reveal something to Peter, James, and John. So what is that saying to us is that we might have all the people who are around us, our family, our friends, whoever they may be, but we cannot reveal our secret to everybody in our circle. You know, we cannot reveal our inner secret to everybody, because one, a lot of people that appears to be for you, you find out they are undercover haters. How many of us know about those undercover haters? The very ones that you thought was for you end up being the one who are against you. So then Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, and he went up into a mountain apart to pray. Now, Jesus, he went there to pray. And you know beforehand, not long hereafter, that Jesus, when he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, that he took with him Peter, James, and John. And he went there to pray. Now take notice here, if you will. While Jesus was praying in a mountain, and while he was praying in a garden, Peter, James, and John fell asleep. So what is that teaching us on this morning is that, yes, we can have our prayer partners. We can have those who pray closely with us. The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. But sometimes they tend to fall asleep on us while we are praying. So who can can tell the Lord better about our problems than we can. So while they are sleeping, we still had to keep on praying. So Jesus, he was in the mountain praying. And check this out. While he was praying, if you read in Matthew and Luke, you'll find that while he was praying, that Jesus was being transformed in the presence of his disciples. So that's how it is. That's how it is. That when we were praying to the Lord, we tend to get caught up. It seemed like a time would stand still for us. It seemed like that while we are praying, that we are transfigured in the midst of our praying. Now, let me put it to you like this then. How many of us have so many things going on in our lifetime, and then but we decide that we're going to pray unto the Lord and tell him all about our problems, and then in the midst of our praying, just seemed like the burden of life started to lift off of us. And you know how we enter into prayer, that sometimes we go there and we are all stressed out and dismayed, and our continents are headed with the worries of the world. But as we pray unto the Lord and we tell him all about our troubles, it seems like the burdens of the world just sort of start lifting up off of us, and then the anointing of God started flowing in our lives. How many of us know that when we pray to the Lord, it seems to make things a whole lot better for us? So they was praying. So prayer, what is prayer then? Prayer is a dialogue between us and God. It's a conversation between us and the Lord. And you know, so many times that we pray and tell God about our problems, but sometimes we need to tell God how that problem made us feel. And believe it or not, that we can go to the Lord just how we are. If you're hurting, you can tell him you're hurting. If you're frustrated, you can tell him you're frustrated. If you go to him and you're happy and you're full of joy, you can tell him you are happy and full of joy. How many of us know that the Lord, he already knows the condition of our hearts, so we don't have to fake it to get in his presence. He just wants us to be real. So while Jesus was there praying, while Jesus was there on the mountain praying, his disciple was there dead, steadily falling asleep. But then as Jesus was as Jesus was praying, the Bible said that his countenance started changing, and his remnant started changing. His garments, he started to be clothed in the glory that he was before he came here on earth. And you know, so he was in his glorious state. His glory was shining upon him, and his countenance began to change. And you know, the more we pray, the more our garment starts to change. The more we start taking up the worldly attitudes and putting on God-like characteristics, we start putting on the glory of God in our lives. So what do you mean then? We start, the more we pray, the more we take off jealousy, the more we take off enviousness, the more we take off hatred, the more we take off the things of the world, the more our minds are being transformed, and the more we are being transfigured, the glory of God will shine in our lives. You see, that's how it is then, that when you give your life to the Lord, and when you are a child of God, that's why some people who you used to hang around with in the world, they cannot recognize who you are now. And you know, because the more you take off the worldly attributes and put on God's attributes, there ought to be something different about you. You know, let me put it to you like this. You remember when Peter denied Jesus, that when Peter was in the courts, and then there someone was in the court, around the courts, and they say, I know that you were one of his disciples. And Peter said, no, that was not me. But then he moved to the other side of the courtroom. And then there was a young damsel that said, I know that you was one of Jesus' disciples. And again, Peter denied Jesus. But then he ran into somebody that was real familiar with him by the name of Malchus, because he cut off Malchus' ear not long ago at Garden of Gethsemane. And he said, I know you was one of him because you cut off my ear. And Peter, to keep from being discovered, he started cursing up a storm. But then what is that saying? That no matter where you go, there ought to be something different about you that will show that you are a child of God. And I wonder, is there anybody here who is a child of God? So then, Jesus, as he was praying, that he was starting to go into his glorious state, and that his brandness was changed, his continuity was changed, and then there appeared with him Moses and Elijah. So the question is, why Moses and Elijah? Moses, he represents the whole context of the law that was given to him on Mount Sinai, and then Elijah represents the whole continuity of the prophets. So you know that Moses and Elijah had prophesied about the coming of the Messiah. So they came down from glory and was there conversating with Jesus about what he would achieve on the cross. So then what is that saying to us is, you know, sometimes God knows the direction we are headed. He knows when there's a bumps in the road, and sometimes he will send us a message from one of his angels to let us know that no matter what you're going through, that everything will be all right. How many of us know that the Lord still have angels, and he will send angels down to visit you to let you know no matter what you go through that you are going to be all right. No wonder that was the psalmist meant when he said, though I walk through the valley and the shadows of death, I shall fear no evil. You see, you might go through the valley, but you are not there to stay. So then there was there conversating with Jesus about what he would have to do on Calvary. I could imagine or hear them saying that they go whip and beat him. I can imagine saying they go put a crown of thorns on your brow. They go put nails in your hands and rivets on your feet. But don't worry, because that third day morning you will rise up, raise up with all power in your hand. So what is that saying to us is, it may be fine now, but hold on, because Sunday morning is coming. So then Peter, he woke up and see this vision of Jesus conversating with Moses and Elijah. So then he said, you know how Peter is, loudmouth Peter. He told to speak out of turn. And then he said, Lord, it is good for us to be here. And I think I need to share notice with you, wherever the Lord is, it is a good place to be. Because wherever Jesus is, bodies can be healed. Wherever Jesus is, miracles can happen. Wherever Jesus is, that demons have to flee. Wherever Jesus is, he tend to make ways out of no way. Wherever Jesus is, he tend to make a difference in our lives. So then, he said, it is good for us to be here. So then he said, let us build three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elias. Because Peter was excited, and he didn't realize what he was saying, and he wanted to put Moses and Elias on the same level
Yahweh will Jesus. And I think I need to share notice with you this morning is that nobody but nobody belongs on the same level with Jesus. Not your mother, not your father, not your pastor, not your deacons, not your choir members, not your children. I tell you, if you worship any of those people, you are putting them on the same level as Jesus. And when you put them on the same level as Jesus, I hear the Lord saying that I am a jealous God. Thou shalt put no other before me. So then Peter wist not, or he knew not what he was saying. But then here come a cloud down in their presence. And out of that cloud represents the presence of God. And out of that cloud came the voice of God. Said, this is my beloved son. Hear ye him. And I think I need to share notice with you. There are a lot of voices in this world. And they come without signification. And I think I need to tell you that if you are a child of God, you ought to know the voice of Jesus. For Jesus said that my sheep hear my voice. My sheep know my voice. You know, just because somebody say they of God, just because somebody say they know the Bible, just because somebody quotes scriptures, that does not mean they know Jesus. That does not mean they know God. So then the cloud came upon them, which is very significant because it represents the presence of God. For you remember that when the Israelites was going through the wilderness, God led them by cloud, by day. And you remember that when Moses was on Mount Sinai getting the commandments from God, that a cloud had engulfed him, which was the presence of God. And you remember that when they had the Solomon's temple, and they had the most holy place, and there in the most holy place, a cloud dwelled over the Ark of the Covenant, and that's what the presence of God, and that was the Shekinah glory of God. So when this cloud came down on Peter, James, and John, they were experiencing the Shekinah glory of God. And I think I need share notice with you. When you're in God's presence, it tends to make all of the difference. When you're in God's presence, it brings about trembling and it brings about fear. But he'll bring you a word of encouragement. Being in God's presence, you will have love in God's presence. You will have joy in God's presence. He tends to make ways for you. In God's presence, you tend to worship him. In God's presence, you tend to give him the praise. Is there anybody here who knows that God's presence can make a difference? So then, when Jesus was there, and God spoke to him and said, this is my beloved son. Hear ye him. And then they woke up from the vision. And then Jesus said, don't you tell no man until I am arisen from the dead. And at that point, point, they didn't realize or recognize that Jesus will be raised from the dead. So they pondered what it means to rise from the dead. Well, now you know that Jesus had died one Friday. You know he had nails in his hands. He died until rivers was in his feet. He died until the temple was written in the mist. He died until a soldier said, surely, this must be the Son of God. And then Joseph and Nicodemus had took him down from their cross and put him in a grave for 3 long days. And that's what he meant when he said, arise from the dead. For early, somebody say early. For early that Sunday morning, Jesus had got out of the grave. He put one foot in the grave and one foot out of the grave. He said, all power was given unto me in heaven and in earth. Is anybody here that knows that Jesus, he is alive? Well, is he all right? Is he all right? Now and then he walks with me, he talks with me, he tells me that I am his own, and the joy, the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Don't you worry, don't you fret. The way we thought about God then, he gives you a new revelation. Is it all right? If you know he's all right, let me say yes. Yes.
Give God a praise up here.
Yes, Lord.
I mean, we know that God will give you a new revelation of himself.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus.
We're going to extend the invitation that you come by letter, Christian Spirit, or candidate for baptism.
Yes, Lord.
If you're looking for a church home, and you would like Rhema Faith Ministries to be your church home, this will be your time to come. A new revelation of Christ, that an anointed one of God. This will be your time to come. If you would like to be a member of this fellowship, this portion of the body of Christ, the body of Christ is a global living organism.
Amen.
But if you want to be a part of it, this will be your time to come. Take some of the lows out of this. This will be your time to come. How many of you know that the Lord will give you a new garment to wear?
Yes, he will.
He'll put some new clothes on you.
Yes.
And
is the Spirit that guides me. The
give God a praise up in here.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let us prepare to give. Let us prepare to give in our do our communion services in our 1 Corinthians.
Yes.
Chapter 11, starting at verse 23. And it reads, I have received of the Lord, which also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.
Yes.
After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if ye would judge yourself, you should not be judged. Let's bow our heads, Lord. We thank you and praise you. Thank you, God, for this time to remember all that you have done for us. Lord God, we just come in the name of Jesus, asking that you will forgive us of our sins. Lord, forgive us of our wrongdoings, recondition our hearts, restore the joy of our salvation in our lives. For Lord God, we forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for all things you have done and what you will do. In the mighty name of Jesus, and all the people said, amen. We have up here our communion kit. We have here our communion kits, and we're going to ask everybody to stand that you will come and partake in the Lord's Supper. Everybody got the kids open?
No.
Jesus took his disciples into the upper room the night before the Passover, and he took bread and blessed it and gave it to his disciples and gave to them to eat, for this is my body. Let's eat. And after the same manner, after he had given thanks, he took the cup of wine and gave it to his disciples and said, this is my body, or this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. Drink ye all of it. Let us drink. Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's all remember on Wednesday, on tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we will have our first Miracle Monday, to where we all call in, spread the word to your family, friends, if they're sick or having any kind of ailment, they need some kind of healing or miracle. We will be praying with them and praying for them through the power and the Spirit of God, that His power will be channeled to heal that person over a manner of diseases they may have or even kind of miracle. Because I believe that God, He is still in a miracle working business.
Amen.
Amen. And then on Wednesday is our Bible study. I believe we're on week 47 or week 48. We're on week 48, going through the book of Matthew. And 48 weeks, and we just now hitting the halfway mark. Amen. So we probably have another several more weeks to go. So remember on tomorrow night at 7 o'clock and then on Wednesday. So spread the word about our Miracle Monday. Miracle Mondays. Let us all stand. And I just had a flashback. Everybody just look at your neighbor and repeat after me. Friend, God loves you. Friend, God loves you. Friend, God loves you, and I love you too. God, we thank you and praise you. We magnify you. Thank you, O God, for all that you have done. Lord God, we thank you for everything you have done in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for a new revelation that there is nothing too hard for you and how you will manifest yourself in our presence. We thank you, O God, for the Shekinah glory. And Lord God, we just come and ask that you be with us as we depart this place. In the mighty name of Jesus, and all the people say, amen.
Amen.
Everybody repeat after me. So then faith comes by hearing.
Comes by hearing.
And hearing by.
And hearing by.
The word of God.
The word of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.